Hi, Mickey.
Hi, Bob.
Wait, that sounds like you've got some prop or something. That was a very odd hi, Bob.
Bob, why would you think I have a prop?
See?
You have Fraser?
Did you get a dog? Did you get a stuffed dog?
You don't know, do you, Bob?
Not yet.
Welcome, I've been waiting for you.
Well, you're going to have to wait a little longer, buddy.
Oh.
That reminds me, actually, I have something I could use as a prop.
I had my pupils dilated, so I'm wearing a giant pair of sunglasses.
Surely you jest, Mickey.
Otherwise I'll be blinded by the lights.
Surely you jest. You're not wearing sunglasses, are you? Please, tell me.
They're not just sunglasses. They're giant sunglasses that go over my regular glasses.
God, this is wonderful if true. I hope it's true.
Well, you're going to be very, very happy, Bob.
Well,
and as
Mickey,
you know,
your
happiness is
all
I care about. Anyway.
Well, we need more Americans like you. So I'm coming to you from Silicon Valley, Mickey.
Really?
On the West Coast, spreading the Blogging Heads gospel. I speak to you from the home of the noted technology guru, Gordon Kotick.
Really?
Yeah. You impressed? You didn't even know I knew him, did you?
I hate to say it, I don't even know who he is.
You don't know who the noted technology... Oh, wow. Okay, that's all right. It's all right. It's a good thing I'm running this
company.
I think
gratuitously insulting your friends is a good way to help you raise money, don't you?
Yeah, well, Gordon isn't a major source of capital. Intellectual capital, I would say.
Cool.
Key strategic counsel. So, anyway, and then I was in San Francisco yesterday where I got a gift from my wife while I was visiting Haight-Ashbury. So you want to guess what it is?
God, there's so many. It's rich with possibilities.
Haight-Ashbury, man, summer of love.
You got a I'm not going to go there, Bob. You got a
no. Okay, summer of peace. How's that?
You got one of a street sign that says Haight-Ashbury.
No, that's too cool.
You got
it's a big peace sign. And it's made of wood, and it's made in Nepal, so it's just got, you know, karma out the wazoo.
How big?
And you know, Mickey, that's a natural segue into our next topic, if you would like it to be. Or our first
it's
topic.
It's a segue into all our topics. It could be a segue into peace in the Middle East or into Tiger Woods' Zen-like calm.
Right, because peace and love.
Well, I actually watched the U.S. Open, at least the last, what was supposed to be the last day, and found myself actually excited about golf, a little bit, not a lot. I mean, golf is inherently boring, but it was a pretty exciting day.
This is the Sunday, the final round?
The Sunday, the final round, when they wind up tied, yes.
Yeah. And we should set the scene for people. Of course, everyone knows who Tiger Woods is, but he was playing with some pain because he had just had knee surgery and came back arguably too soon. Although it did provide a good stage for his heroics, he wound up winning the tournament. But the interesting thing was that the challenger down the stretch was Rocco Mediate, who, first of all, 45 years old. And when anybody wins a major, one of the four major golf tournaments at age 45, it's headlines. I mean, Nicklaus won one, I think, 46. He was like the greatest golfer ever in his day, and it was headlines. And now Rocco Mediate is a guy who... was perennial middle-of-the-pack guy, never won a major. All of a sudden, at age 45, he's in contention. He's this affable, lovable guy who captures your heart naturally. And on top of that, he's wearing a peace sign belt buckle. Did you notice that?
I noticed that. It was not very becoming.
It was wonderful. What a great man. And then his last name is Mediate, you know, like mediate between conflicting sides. It's just like perfect symbolism. You didn't think about
it. It's a harbinger of the Obama era.
Well, we'll talk about that later. So anyway, miraculously, Mediate is ahead and going into the 18th hole of the final round. Tiger birdies to catch him, and the U.S. Open, rather than do sudden death, plays a whole another 18 holes the next day. And Mediate shockingly hangs in there. Once again, he's one ahead, I think, going into the 18th. I watched almost none of this, but... and then Tiger catches him again. So then they go into extra innings, you know, sudden death,
right.
And finally Tiger wins. So it was amazing. It was. I mean, it was objectively, even if you didn't know who the participants were, just about the most amazing U.S. Open in history. And then given that one is this demigod playing with an injury and the other is this, you know, well, every man wearing a peace sign on his belt.
I was excited, but all I could say is if that's as exciting as golf gets, golf is not very exciting.
Well, golf is a game, not all games like this, you have to play it to enjoy watching it.
I guess. But did you have some larger point keying off David Brooks's column today, which really
was... I mainly just wanted to note that David Brooks mentioned me in his column, which doesn't happen every day, when he wrote about Tiger Woods.
You said you didn't want to do that. You said you had some larger point other than pointing out that David Brooks mentioned you.
Did I?
Yes.
I think you're getting me mixed up with somebody else who was mentioned by David Brooks in this column. There's a point about David Brooks.
Okay.
Can I make one of those?
Yeah, you can make one of those.
Okay. So, he does this, a column on Tiger Woods, quotes something I wrote in Slate, in a piece that's actually about 12 years old, that I wrote at the beginning of Tiger Woods' career, when as Brooks puts it, I semi-facetiously compared Woods to Gandhi for his ability to live in the present and achieve transcendent awareness. It's more or less true. Anyway, Brooks's point is that, well, first of all, that we're making a big hero out of Tiger Woods, true, and that we're attributing to him, we're emphasizing his ability to focus. And, of course, the thing about Brooks, I mean, he's a great writer, he's a great columnist, I read him, but he does have this tendency to announce every other column that we're entering a whole new age, or that there's some epic earth-shaking trend unfolding that he then gives a name to, right? I mean...
Good point.
It's always, right? I mean, you've noticed this?
Yes.
And into every news event, he kind of sees as anecdotal evidence for one of these things. Okay, and this is the way he took the Tiger Woods, all the celebration of Tiger Woods, and as I understand his argument, what he's saying is that because we live in an age when it's such a challenge to concentrate with this information overload and all these distractions. And focus and cutting through all that clutter and focusing is the key to success. We've created this hero in Tiger Woods who does exactly that, right? Everyone emphasizes his focus.
Right.
And, you know, and it just seems to me, I mean, there could be a little of that, our reading the ideal of the age into Tiger Woods, but as is sometimes the case with the David Brooks argument about some grand trend unfolding, there's actually a simpler, less dramatic explanation, which is that Tiger Woods is the most amazing athlete in the world. A, that's why we're turning him into a hero. And B, in general in golf, golf is the biggest head game of any of them, and I would say tennis comes in second. And the key to success is focus. It's just true. I mean, and Tiger Woods has... Part of his success, in addition to being an amazing physical specimen who's spent his whole life practicing, and he's a perfectionist and a control freak, is his focus. His ability to block it all out and just be totally in the moment.
What struck me
was just a fact. We're just telling the truth. We're lionizing a guy who is in fact the greatest athlete of his time, and we're emphasizing the characteristic that is in fact the key to his success, and. That's what's going on. I'm sorry. It's just not that we're reading this into him because of our own psychological needs.
Well, plus, the quality of single-minded focus that Brooks talks about, first, it's not clear that it's generally applicable. In other words, if you're a president who is single-mindedly focused, you're George Bush on Iraq, which is perhaps why David Brooks likes it. But the difficult thing as a leader is being open to new information. The classic example being Al Gore in Florida didn't realize that the key wasn't to count the undervotes, it was to count the overvotes in counties he hadn't looked at before, and he got that information too late. If he'd been less focused and more bombarded with emails and more open to new information and less cocooned, he would have been a better leader. So sort of focus can be detrimental to being a good president. At least it's certainly not a model for a whole lot other than sports, I wouldn't think.
Yeah, I mean, actually, you could argue that that kind of excessive focus, I mean, if you're curious, is some people would argue is better embodied in Phil Mickelson, who, you know, I mean, the guy is intent on hitting the great shot, and if he gets into trouble, he kind of doesn't acknowledge, well, the rap on him, I think he gets a bad rap, actually, I'm a Mickelson defender, but anyway, the rap on him is that he will not acknowledge when he's in such hopeless trouble that he should just adopt a conservative strategy and settle for reaching the green in two instead of one. That's kind of the George Bush golfer. But you could argue that Tiger Woods actually is open to new information. You know, when he's in a bad way and it's beyond his... He knows his limitations, I mean, and his limitations are so far beyond those of any other mortal, but he does know them and adapt his game to them, I would say, better than some pros.
The other point that I thought... The point I thought Brooks was going to make is that, which maybe he's getting another column out of, is that Woods has the right attitude toward his racial background, i.e. he's genuinely multiracial, whereas Barack Obama has the traditional identity politics attitude, which is, if you have a multiracial background, you have to pick one and be authentic within that category. So he has a white mother and a black father, and he's decided, hey, I'm going to be black. And his whole book is about deciding, hey, he's black. Whereas Woods says, I can't slight any part of my heritage. I am who I am. That's the correct attitude.
First of all, of course, Obama's a politician, and any politician would probably look at what aspect of his identity he could emphasize to his greatest advantage. And at least coming up, you know, in Chicago politics, it was probably good to say, hey, I'm black. The other thing is, Woods is more multidimensional ethnically. I mean, he's got white, he's got American Indian, apparently. His mother is from Thailand. And there's a great quote from his mother in the David Brooks column where she's talking about her husband, Woods' father. She says, old man is soft. He cry. He forgive people. Not me. I don't forgive anybody.
But
it's tough. You know, it's interesting. I think when I wrote that Slate column Brooks alludes to, I was kind of hoping that that Woods would use his multi-ethnic, you know, kind of global identity someday after finishing with his career to do great good in the world. I now have doubts as to whether that's actually his inclination. Even though his father said that he alluded to, you know, implied that he was going to do great things
I don't understand. What's he going to do, fly to Darfur?
Well, the guy has a global following. I mean, you know, that gives you a platform that a lot of people don't have. Yeah, if you want to stand up and say things and you know, produce, generate a message of, you know, inclusion, you know, peace and love, brother.
Well, I think they're...
ELE, man, ELE. Have you seen that movie?
No, but I've never. All these people who want to use their celebrity for good, I can't say that I have very high hopes for anybody actually achieving it.
They tend to ultimately embarrass themselves. Is that what you're saying?
Well, it's just the effect is marginal. I mean, it's you know how. I mean, who's the best example? I mean, Bono, Bill Clinton. I mean, what's the
Well, Bono has gotten stuff done. You may disagree with it, right?
No, but, that's why I said he's the best example.
Oh, okay. But, well, Bill Clinton's not an example because he's a politico. But what's her name? Audrey Hepburn.
I think Mia Farrow is addressing the United Nations.
Yeah,
I think her address is on HuffPo. Anyway, well, I think this just mainly proves that, like Fraser, your dog, Tiger Woods reduces you to a mewling, fawning fanboy.
Oh, I was voting for mediate because on grounds of the peace symbol, the peace sign.
Okay. I was for mediate.
And
just
most people were, and Brooks explained this as most were probably rooting for Rocco, but only because Woods, the inevitable victor, has risen above mere human status and become an embodiment of immortal excellence. Once again, an anecdote is, fact is, fits with suspicious convenience and overarching thesis. I mean, in fact, I'm guessing that they were rooting for Rocco Mediate because he's this 45-year-old middle-of-the-pack guy who was having his chance for greatness. Yeah. But anyway.
Yeah, Brooks has the fastest new paradigm in the West.
I'll tell you, though, I admire a mind that can continually bend the world to its will in that manner. I wish I could.
Anyway, that wasn't his best column, so...
From my point of view, it was. The first time he's mentioned me, and he wasn't all that critical, really.
I'm glad we talked about it for half an hour.
Hey, this golf fan's out there.
Better than talking about basketball in Los Angeles, that's for sure.
Yeah, that thing ended. The Celtics polished off the Lakers last night, right?
So I hear.
Yeah, true.
Anyway, don't you feel an urge?
So, in other news, Mickey, we're a little late on the Tim Russert thing. I guess he died 2 days after we last taped.
Yeah, I was sort of paralyzed because there was...
Yeah, you didn't blog on it.
Well, there's this imperative on the web to sort of commemorate the moment. I've been getting grief from some people. Why didn't you commemorate the moment that Obama became the nominee? And why didn't you?
They wanted you to join in the outpouring of grief over Tim Russert. Did they expect you to do that?
It basically means going on the web and writing something that you may not completely agree with because it's sort of appropriate in terms of etiquette. And I just resist that urge. It was the only interesting things I had about Russert are things that you don't say when a guy has just disastrously died and left a family in the middle of his life.
But now some time has passed, and you're...
Well, a little time has passed.
You say whatever you want, right?
I mean, I don't think he was an authentic guy. I think when he was nice to people, he probably was actually nice.
And you get points for that. That's good.
I have friends who know his wife, and Maureen Orth is, they're good people. They had a good family. The basic, Russert was, I always thought that in order to be a really good Washington columnist, you had to live in Washington because you had to actually hear the conventional wisdom as it left Tim Russert's lips at a party in order to be able to comment on it, react against it fast enough to beat everybody else.
So was he? Do you give him that level of significance, at least the official found conventional wisdom?
I think he was very, very central, and that's why people are sort of astounded that Washington reacted the way it did. It's not just that he was, bureau chief of NBC and on TV. He was more important than Tom Brokaw and more important than Dan Rather. More important than an anchorman because he...
That used to be unthinkable.
He formulated the conventional wisdom, which is not easy to do. I mean, somebody's got to do it. And everything he said was sort of safe and approved analysis. He never really strayed from that, which was his problem, but was also the source of his power. I mean, he was at the center of the whole mechanism of conventional wisdom generation. So I think that's part of it. And the other part of it is this weird Washington veneration of sort of heartland everyman values, which Washington doesn't really share that much. It shares them more than New York City. But there's still this sort of worry that you've lost touch with the folks back home. Newsweek puts out a magazine every week that's read by people in the Midwest. They don't really know what people in the Midwest are thinking, so they sort of have to guess, and they're very insecure about it. Sometimes they overreact, sometimes they underreact. But a guy like Russert, who seems to be the very embodiment of ordinary Americans, is especially prized because this helps reduce that insecurity. You figure if it passes the Russert test, well, your audience is going to like it. If Newsweek really put out the magazine that its writers were really interested in, it would look a lot closer to Gawker.com and less like Newsweek.
I thought that the reason that first of all, was the outpouring of grief somewhat greater than you would have expected?
No, I think it's exactly what I expected. It was stunning. It was the guy's 58.
Part of it is, although 58 is too young to die of a heart attack, still, he looked even younger than that, I think.
Well, plus his father, plus his father's still alive, so...
Right.
That...
Big Russ, is that his...
Yeah, so...
Big Russ? Well,
I mean, it's that's what's so disastrous about it.
But I mean, also in terms of the publicity, also, first of all, the NBC machinery was kind of pushing it big time, but in part to you know, elevate Meet the Press from merely venerable to hallowed, you know. I mean, not to be too cynical about it. I mean, and also, and you know, that's a lot of heft. I mean, NBC, MSNBC, the MSNBC website, but also apparently he was nice to everybody in the business, his colleagues and other people, and look, you know, the time you clean up on that is when you die, you know. If you're a journalist and you're nice to everybody in your business, that's when you reap the reward, I guess. It's kind of unfair that you have to wait until you are not around to witness it. But so that's what I mean, it did surprise me. I got to say, when I turned on the TV yesterday in my Holiday Inn in San Francisco, and they're, like, televising, like, the funeral or something, I mean, I just thought...
Well, keep in mind, it's a slow news day. So what he's competing against, you know, Fox's coverage of a woman who got a defective thong from Victoria's Secret. So,
and she's suing them.
I guess you know, it beats that. If there was a war on, it would be like David Blum dying. He was central to NBC.
I don't know. I would lead with the thong personally.
Yeah.
If I'm editor of the New York Times, I lead with the thong.
And I'm not sure Russert was always nice. On the way up, Lloyd Grove wrote a profile of him decades ago that sort of, if you read between the lines, it sort of nailed him.
Well, the other thing is, I mean, nice is often self-serving, and it's good that we live in a world where nice is often, you know, you can do well by doing good, but for example, I mean, on Blogging Heads, Dan Dresner was doing this kind of Russert appraisal, and he mentioned that you know, Jamie Kirchner, I guess is his name, young journalist in New Republic, wrote this thing about somebody, I guess Ron Paul, whom Russert had interviewed, and Kirchner got this stuff that Russert hadn't, so Russert wrote him this, like, email saying, wow, how'd you get that stuff? That's great. Well, you know, being nice to rising young journalists, you know, has its rewards, you know, I mean, over time. It's not the same as stopping to help homeless people on the street. I would say. Am I being too cynical? Is
no,
that what
no,
you're
I think
say?
You're being exactly cynical enough, but, you know.
But it's just that it's too soon to say that? Should I have waited another 3 days?
No, everybody knows that's what you think, Bob. You think... No,
I don't think
read
many
your
people
book.
Think
we're
at
all
all
nice.
Think about what I think at all.
We're all nice for at all. For suspect, self-interested reasons, so.
Well, not necessarily consciously. It's just that, you know. It's not the same as helping people who can never possibly help you. That is goodness, and it's not like I do that very often.
He famously didn't like Chris Matthews. Maybe he was nice to Chris Matthews, but
oh, really? Did he famously not like him?
That came out in the Libby trial.
Mm. The only thing I'd say, his interview style, it had the virtue of him trying to press you to actually answer the question. He'd ask the question, and if you didn't answer, he'd repeat it, you know, right? I mean, am I right? I didn't watch him that much, but that's true, right?
But then really he sort of gave up, unless you were Hillary Clinton fudging an answer about a legal driver's license. I mean, he is largely responsible for you know, starting Hillary Clinton's slide into defeat. Remember, he nailed her.
Right?
He nailed her on that illegal driver's license issue. And wouldn't let up and produced this incredibly embarrassing, fumfoing reaction from her that started her decline.
Well, politicians are too often let off with just dodging the question.
Yeah.
So I guess that part of his interviewing style is good.
Yeah,
right?
But it was... Well, I know you're stalling here because you don't want to discuss Social Security means testing, Bob.
I would give anything not to have to get to means testing. But I will say... Can I say one more thing?
Okay, but I have a perfect transition, but go ahead.
Okay, first my one thing. Just the downside was his interviews were non-interactive. I mean, he had a list of questions. He would ask them. They were kind of gotcha questions a little bit.
They were all gotcha questions.
But he would never follow, you know, kind of, he didn't exhibit a lot of dexterity. He would never follow an answer to an interesting place it seemed to be leading. If the follow-up question was not already written on his list
right.
of questions, there are a lot of interviewers like
unlike
that.
Blogging Heads, he wasn't trying to explore or learn anything new or expose the public to anything new or think through questions. He was all trying to generate a news story through a gotcha question, and it involved putting the conventional wisdom here and what the candidate says here and showing that the conventional wisdom was right and embarrassing the candidate because he didn't match the conventional wisdom. And the classic example of that and his worst moment was when he grilled Ross Perot about, yes, means testing Social Security, and tried to argue incorrectly that Ross Perot's plan to means test Social Security wouldn't raise very much money.
Mickey,
instead of the
that
hundreds,
is an excellent,
instead of
excellent
the tens
transition.
Of billions, now approaching $100 billion, that you could raise by means testing Social Security. And the reason that's interesting is because Obama, for some reason, has put out all these specifics about his economic plans. I don't know why. I think it might be stupid. But
not specific enough, right? I mean, he came out with this thing where Social Security taxes are going to kick in again at 250,000 household income, and they asked him for details, and then his spokesperson said, well, we haven't worked that out, and Paul Krugman gave him some grief for that, right?
No, well, but even that, no, the problem with that is not that he wasn't specific enough. The problem is that as specific as he was, it was clear he is thinking of a very large increase in marginal tax rates on the rich. You know, right now, the Social Security...
I'm for that.
Right now, the Social Security tax is 6.2% on the employee, 6.2% on the employer. People think, in effect, the employee winds up paying both halves. It stops at about $102,000, and then you're home free. You don't have to pay it anymore if you get as your income goes up. On an analogy with an insurance plan, that, you know, this is like contributing to an insurance policy. Once you pay for the policy, you don't have to pay anymore. Obama wants to stop it at 102, but then pick it up again at 250. And keep in mind that's a 6.2% just tax on top of all the other taxes, income taxes, et cetera, et cetera. And if you're self-employed, it's 6.2 times 2, 12.4. So it's basically adding 12.4% to the marginal tax rate of the rich. And the Tax Policy Center, which is not a conservative outfit, it's a pretty liberal outfit, the Brookings Institution and the Urban Institute, points out that this, with state taxes on top of that, pushes the marginal tax rates for rich people into the 50s and 60s, which is, as Paul Krugman correctly says, is you know, those are rates we haven't seen since before Reagan in the 70s. And the reason we got rid of them is because they encouraged tax shelters. Then the rich spend all their time figuring out how to avoid this 60% rate instead of building things that people want and being taxed at an ordinary 30-40% rate. So low tax rates are a good thing because they eliminate the insidious shelter business. And Obama, by piling on...
Well, they don't eliminate it, though, right? I mean...
Well, they radically curtail it, yeah. It's no accident that the tax reform of 86 was followed by an economic boom, I think, because people started...
Yeah, but I'm saying it's not like, you know, you cut tax rates in half and shelters disappear. It's more like shelters get cut in half. I mean... To some extent, the rich are always going to play the shelter game, and the way to eliminate that is to tax them not at all, but we can't, that's crazy, so...
Right, but it radically reduces the allure of shelters and the money you can be made at shelters, and at some point it becomes not worth doing.
Well, you could always, you know, build a tax code that didn't have so many shelters, which they kind of tried to do in the 80s with Bill Bradley and... So on.
Well, Reagan did a lot of that. He dramatically reduced marginal tax rates.
Well, that was actually Bradley's initiative that Reagan wound up getting credit for, but I digress.
Well, sure, but so what?
One's a Democrat, one's a Republican. But anyway, we do digress.
But here's... I haven't even gotten to my point yet, which is by making Social Security such a bad deal for the rich... And eliminating this contributory fiction that is just like an insurance policy, it seems to me he's setting the stage for means testing. Because opponents of means testing have always, which would be taking the benefits away from the rich, not just taxing the rich, but saying if you're rich, you don't get Social Security, has been, oh, well, then the rich people will bail out because they won't think it's a good deal. Well, it's not a good deal under Obama either, because they're paying through the nose for taxes for benefits they don't need.
It's true, it's not a good deal, but I still would say that there's a big difference. I mean, if we're talking about whether rich people will just bail out of, you know, as you said, the fear of means testing is that you erode support for Social Security at all among the people who wind up not getting any benefits. But it seems to me there is a big difference between taking away their benefits and making them pay a lot more into the system, even if you make them pay more into the system than they're getting, you know, in benefits, right? I think it's just something symbolically, psychologically weighty about not getting any benefits at all from the system, right? That just puts you in a different psychological space and undermines support for it in a way that increasing the payments by a like amount doesn't do.
That's the question, and it just seems to me that that's an interesting debate. If you ask rich people, if I walked down the street and asked the first, multimillionaire that I saw, would you rather not pay 6% extra in taxes or not have Social Security? 95% of them are going to say, I'll give up my benefits, just don't tax me. So the actual rich people themselves, I think, would prefer a means-tested system. The problem is that, if you want to save $100 billion by cutting benefits, you have to cut more than just the benefits of rich people. You have to cut the benefits of, say, the top third of the income distribution, so you wind up potentially pissing off, the top and most influential third. It's not clear that with all the deleterious effects of having these high marginal tax rates, that it's not just simpler, just a means test.
Well, maybe simpler, but again, it's not clear to me that psychologically it's the same thing. And I think psychologically you wind up undermining support more if you mean test. But another question is, if something kicks in at $250,000 of household income, we're talking about a very small percentage of the population that's affected, right?
Less,
like not me, for example?
Less small than you'd think, because...
I would think 1 or 2%. What is?
Yeah, I think it's 1 or 2%. But I thought you were going to say
pretty
it's
small.
It's not 0.1%. It's one. When Lawrence O'Donnell went on McLaughlin, said he thought it was horrible that people who make only $350,000 a year were taxed at the same rate as people who make $1 million a year, and I thought that was absurd because who makes $350,000 a year? It turns out that 1% of the population makes $350,000 a year, because if you add two incomes together, that they add up. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of rich people around these days. So it's more than you think. But, yeah, it's 1%.
Well, then it's 2%. Not more than I think, because that's what I guessed, right? but anyway, that's not very much in political terms, right? I mean, unless, of course, they're disproportionately influential because they have money. But, again, we're going to take their money away so they won't anymore. It's a great point.
It's disproportionately influential.
Then it'll be one man, one vote.
It's disproportionately influential. People, who avoid it. A few more percent will avoid trying this tax, so it affects 4 or 5 more percent. People wind up making $250,000 one year and pay the tax, and then the next year they don't. So it winds up hitting more of the population than just the 1%. I suspect that what will happen is that Henry Aaron of Brookings already is on record as opposing this tax.
And by the way, Henry Aaron of Brookings is not the one who hit over 700 home runs.
Right.
I always try to clarify.
Right.
That.
In his dreams, he hit over. He's a veteran policy analyst at Brookings, and a straight shooter. And so I think if Aaron's against it, the liberal establishment will ultimately put the kibosh on this, because they will worry about there are simpler ways just to keep Social Security solvent, other than heaping these huge tax increases on the rich, and I think we'll wind up with one of them, the result of which, as Krugman points out, is we're not going to end up saving money on Social Security that we could add to health care, which is what I want to do. We're just going to end up balancing Social Security on its own bottom, which is unfortunate. Because where's Obama going to get the money for health care? I don't understand.
Well, the philosophy of the present administration is that you don't have to get the money from anywhere. You just keep spending and borrowing. Do Democrats have to play by different rules?
No, the administration doesn't want to have a universal health care system, so they don't want to pay for it.
No, but they had this somewhat pricey war, and they didn't exactly raise taxes to pay for that.
Yeah, well, that's the issue of the deficit. I don't think Obama has solved the deficit problem either.
Well, no, but you just said, where is he going to get the money? I mean, I thought we had quit looking for money. We just borrow.
He just hired a chief
economist.
Where's
he going to get the money for health care? Borrow it. I guess that's what we do, right? That's what the American government does.
He just hired a chief economist from the Hamilton Project, which is a Bob Rubin, let's balance the budget project. So Obama at least pretends to be a deficit hawk, and McCain's whole shtick is that he's a deficit hawk, too. He claims he's going to get it through unspecified spending cuts. Anyway, the other question is it's pretty clear that Obama's going to tax the rich as much as he possibly can, okay? I mean, he does it in little bites, a little bite here, a little bite there, a little phase out here, a little phase out there. But he's going to soak the rich as much as possible. The question is, will it do anything to reduce the underlying income inequality? And I just don't know whether it's enough. I mean, the Tax Policy Center says it's an immediate cut of 11% in the top 1,000th of the economy, the 0.1%, the richest 0.1%, will lose 11% of their income to taxes. And, you know, in 5 years, they'll wind up losing 5% of their income in taxes. Now, 5%, I think, is clearly not enough to undo the decades of growing income inequality that the economy has generated. I don't even think 11% is, so it's sort of a proof that you cannot reverse income inequality through the tax code.
Well, but it mitigates it, right? I mean, you always do this and act as if things are binary, and if you can't completely solve a problem, there's no point in doing anything. It helps a little.
No, I think it does mitigate. And in fact, you know, Obama used, in a Wall Street Journal interview, uses the word cushion. But if you listen to the rhetoric on the left, it's not mitigate, it's we want to reverse. And
you just got a lot less loud.
Go back
Did you, like,
to the,
drop
the
a
days
phone or
when
something?
America was more of a solid middle-class country, and that's not going to happen. So the upshot I draw is that even if you do as much as you can through the tax code, you have to come up with some other strategy for getting what you liked about that nice middle-class country through means other than redistributing income. Why is that
Mickey,
a crazy position?
Mickey, why are you not as audible as you were, like, 45 seconds ago?
Bob, I can't hear you. Sorry.
While Mickey is away, we've replaced his coffee with Folgers crystals.
Hi.
Hi, Mickey. I have a question for you.
Yeah?
How do you know when God is trying to send you a sign that you've spent enough time talking about Social Security? Thank you.
We were off Social Security. We were on income inequality and social equality. What could be more important than that?
Sorry, my attention must have lapsed. And also, something went wrong that you're in technically. But anyway, go ahead. We were talking about income inequality.
No, I was just saying, if you can't achieve income inequality, if you can't restore old income inequality, what's wrong with finding some other strategy to produce the social equality, which is the reason why you like the income inequality and the income equality in the first place?
Well, social equality is good. Why not do both? You know, do one of your social equality schemes, like create a mass transit system and force everyone at gunpoint to use it.
Well, but
something.
The problem is if you pursue only the income equalization route, you're tempted to push things beyond the point at which they become economically counterproductive. So you get things like marginal tax rates in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, which is pretty much a disaster. And Obama seems to be heading in that direction. That's the problem.
One thing I am increasingly not worried about is Obama being radical about anything. Let's face it, his overwhelming tendency right now is to move to the center, which means from where he's been, moving to the right.
Thank God.
Which could be a transition to the next thing we're going to talk about.
It could be.
But not only if you want.
It could be, but I welcome his pivot.
Of course you do. He's moving to the right. You're loving it, man.
Well, one of the big worries is that he's at heart way to the left of where we want him to be, where I want him to be.
Nobody who's been paying attention is worried about that anymore.
Well, do you think so? We're still worried about it on Iraq, Bob. He hasn't. I mean, he did send this quiet assurance to the Iraqi foreign minister that he didn't, really mean what he seems to be saying about withdrawing precipitously and snatching defeat from the jaws of victory. It was sort of an Austin Goolsbee moment. But nobody, but he's going to get grief for that. Huffington Post is already attacking him. So it's not clear to me that he's moved sufficiently to the center on Iraq. If he does, I think he's won the election.
Well, it's very hard for him to move at all because he so definitively said, get the troops out of there within a year. I don't think you can imagine a rapid pivot on that. I think that's going to be a thing where, now that we're in the White House, we have access to new information, and we realize that.
Yeah, okay.
You know, but the fundamental difference between him and McCain on this, from my point of view, is it's one thing to fudge a little and leave them in 2 years, 3 years. It still seems to me that given his pledge to get them out within a year, they've got to be out by the end of his term. And that strongly distinguishes him from McCain, so I'm happy about that.
But you're really just thinking about Jerusalem, Bob. I know you.
Yeah, it's seldom far from my thoughts.
You're upset that he told AIPAC that he wanted Jerusalem to be undivided.
Well, we've already talked about that. We talked about that last week, yes.
Did you know that his aide, I think just either today or yesterday, came out and said, well, he didn't realize that was a code word.
Is that right?
That is right. It's incredibly embarrassing.
Well, I'm still glad they said it, because I the walk back was so unconvincing before that. I'm just glad. But although, I got to say, I heard the complete quote on the radio today, and it's actually even more damning than I had thought. I mean, just a little background. He said, you know, Jerusalem must remain undivided. Well, everyone who's thinking seriously about a two-state solution knows that the Palestinians have to be able to say East Jerusalem is our capital in our state. Doesn't mean they get all of it. They got to get some of it. And Obama said Jerusalem must remain undivided, which to everyone means, oops, you're wrong. You don't get East Jerusalem as your capital.
Although
under international law, it is theirs. You know, it's not within the Israel of the pre-67 borders. So, but the thing I heard on the radio today, I didn't realize how explicitly he put it in the context of a two-state solution. He said, "The Palestinians, there should be two states. The Palestinians deserve a state, but." You know, Israel must remain a Jewish state with defensible borders, and Jerusalem must remain undivided. So he specifically put it, you know, in as an asterisk to any two-state solution. So it's actually good. I don't know. It continues to amaze me.
I think the back down is sort of more embarrassing. I mean. As long as the status of Jerusalem is negotiated, what difference does it make what the United States thinks? If the Israeli government wants Jerusalem to be divided, we're not going to say, oh, no, you can't divide Jerusalem.
No, but we talked about this last time, and I said that the Israeli government also often needs, for political purposes, to say the U.S. government is pushing us into this.
Okay.
And if the president has said, no, I don't want it to be divided, then it's kind of hard to make that claim.
Okay,
that's why this is really consequential.
Well, here's what his aide said. Democrat Barack Obama misused a code word in Middle East politics, but that does not mean he is naive on foreign policy, a top advisor said. So he used a word to represent what he did not want to see again, and then realized afterwards that word is a code word in the Middle East.
Well, but here's the question, is where's the staff work?
Exactly.
Now, again,
well, that's a point that the commentary blog made,
Bob. What's that?
The commentary blog made that point. It's not an excuse because you're supposed to have staffers who cast this.
Not only that, we know who some of them are. Dennis Ross is one of them. There's no way Dennis Ross didn't see that speech. Now, as I said last week, this is, in a way, him getting punished for firing Rob Malley, who definitely would have raised a red flag, okay? And by the way, Rob Malley was fired because he made some kind of contact with moderate elements in Hamas. Now, today's headlines are, Israel confirms that it and Hamas have reached a six-month ceasefire or truce after discussions mediated by Egypt. So Israel was talking about Hamas. So once again, on this too, both Barack Obama and McCain are to the right of the Israeli government on this kind of thing.
But the larger lesson seems to be Obama, when confronted with a test, tends to throw the guy overboard or make a concession. And that's why I don't think his tax rates are going to end up at 60-70%, because under attack he just starts conceding.
Well, I think though he had a special fear of AIPAC because of the whole whisper campaign to say he's anti-Israel, which is based partly in Jeremiah Wright's utterances and so on. So I think he had kind of a special fear here. But it's true he has a tendency to just kind of cut ties as I said before, it's a mistake because to continue like abandon people and positions whenever he's under fire, because if there's one thing worse than a Democrat being seen as having a wimpish foreign policy, it's being seen as a wimp. Americans, more than they want a foreign policy that is itself muscular, right? I mean, Americans don't think much about foreign policy. Above all, they want a president who seems like he will stand up for what he believes in.
Well, that's a long-term problem for the guy.
What's that?
That is a long-term problem for Obama.
Well, he could correct it easily. If he had not done this epic, AIPAC pander to begin with, that created the thing that he then had to walk back from, that's like two acts of cowardice in one.
I mean, it's possible that the aides did object to it and he overrode them, right?
I find that very hard to believe. I find that very hard to believe. And I just... There needs to be some good reporting on this. Who put that into the speech? Was it Dennis Ross?
My guess is it was David Axelrod.
No, God, no.
You're talking to AIPAC, you got to say this, then they'll love you.
I know. Well, look, it's a good question, and there needs to be reporting on this. But I will...
Are there any
by
other...
By the way, I...
Are there any other areas? Go ahead, Tori.
Well, over the weekend, I was talking to someone who... Well, I guess since it wasn't like talking to him on the record, I should not say who it was. Somebody who's an Israeli negotiator in the final rounds of... or at Taba, right after Camp David, has worked in the Israeli government, has been on Blogging Heads, if you'd like, if there are any more clues you'd like. But first of all, he agreed with me that what you doubted last week when I said that, look, this is lose-lose because once he walked back the statement about divided Jerusalem, he just sowed new doubts in the minds of the people in AIPAC he was trying to suck up to in the first place. Now, you denied that because you said, I know pro-AIPAC people who didn't mind at all, but after the dialogue I talked to, it turned out that those were people who loved Obama. Those weren't the people who had the suspicions, the people you were talking about. This guy, this Israeli negotiator, agreed with me that Obama, that the people in AIPAC would be more suspicious than ever after the walk back, A. But I will say, on Obama's behalf, that this guy said there was some interesting new language in the AIPAC speech that got overlooked in terms of kind of how strongly he stressed that the Iraq war had not been in Israel's interest or something. So maybe we should give him credit for something. But it's still a very unfortunate episode.
Is there any issue where you're worried about his pivot to the right other than Israel?
Well, I'm not on domestic policy. On foreign policy broadly, I am. I mean, when he... Some of the pivots started early, like, I will drop bombs on Pakistan at will if I think al-Qaeda people are hiding out. That bothered me. In general, his rightward panders on foreign policy bother me. I don't... As you know, I'm much more interested in foreign policy than domestic policy. And also in domestic policy, I'm probably, closer to the center than I am on foreign policy. In general, whenever he moves to the right, he hasn't done a lot of it. He's done it occasionally with statements like that. And then the kind of walk back on Iran we talked about, that bothers me too. The AIPAC speech bothers me. But I've been talking to Obama supporters. That got everyone who's really paying attention to foreign policy and is an Obama supporter that I've talked to is just shocked by that thing. And that leads us to our commenters, okay? Last week, or did you want to say something else?
No, go ahead.
Okay, well, last week you were saying I was making too big a thing about this, blah, blah, blah. Okay, well, here is our commenter. And there were a number of commenters who shared that criticism, after I criticized Obama on the AIPAC speech. B.J. Keefe, the prolific and venerable Blogging Heads commenter, says, it's been a while since I've heard anything but criticism of Obama from Bob, which is fine if that's what he genuinely has on his mind, but it's starting to sound MSM-ish, an overreaction to worry about being criticized for being in the tank for Obama or for being part of the liberal media in general. I think you'll agree I've done a fair amount of McCain bashing over the weeks. But anyway, oh, come on, joins in and is looking for an explanation. I think it is possible Bob has been following Obama's statements and has not heard much of what McCain has been saying lately. That may be somewhat true. But anyway, to my defense springs the commenter M.V. Antony, who, Mickey, lives in Israel, okay? And here's what he says. since, as Bob pointed out, the idea of East Jerusalem being under Israeli control isn't one that even Israeli governments have taken seriously, at least since Oslo. I nearly choked on my lunch when I heard Obama's Jerusalem comment. I listened to the speech live from my home in Israel. It left me not knowing what to make of the man, clueless, careless, dishonest, or his position on Israel. I gotta say, that was very much my reaction, like straining for an explanation.
Well, Bob, I can assure you that I'm not worried that you're too hard on Obama.
I know you're not. I know you're not. So. But look, there's a larger issue, and it's a tough one. I was listening to Ralph Nader on the radio today, you know. And by the way, he, in reference to this, you know, I'm like in Pacifica radio territory in Northern California. I'm driving around listening to these radio stations that originate in Berkeley and stuff. They're the ones who are interviewing Ralph Nader, you know. And,
right.
And Nader, in reference, they ask him about Obama's AIPAC speech, and he referred to Obama as panderer-in-chief. Not a bad play on commander-in-chief, I guess. But anyway, I was thinking about the whole issue of, you know, Ralph Nader, and, you know, when have you gone too far in trying to keep your candidate honest from your point of view? In other words, I mean, I'm thinking, look, as he starts to move to the right on foreign policy, we've got to hold his feet to the fire and say, don't take your base for granted, or else by November, he'll be McCain. You know, he'll be 1 inch to the left of McCain on foreign policy. And so, it's funny, it's kind of, yeah.
So when I try to keep him honest, from my point of view, you attack me as treasonous, but when you try to keep him honest from your point of view, all of a sudden it's okay.
Exactly. I'm glad you see it my way. I was afraid you wouldn't understand, Mickey. When I do it, it's okay. When you do it, it's treason.
But that, I don't care what McCain thinks at this point, because it seems clear to me he's going to lose. I mean, so the important...
Oh, you are so wrong. You are so wrong.
The important thing is what Obama thinks.
You are so wrong. McCain has such a good chance of winning.
He has a reasonable chance because of the
crazy
electoral
map. I don't understand how you, like me, can see that Obama... We both seized on the grandmother line in the race speech and thought, uh-oh, okay... and I don't see, if you understand how damaging a line like that is, I don't understand how you can sit there and say there's no way McCain can win. There's massive doubts about Obama out there in among swing voters in swing states. And meanwhile, the base, if he's not careful, it's going to cool on him because he is moving to the right. So anyway.
I still think, you know, the doubts about him are good for 5 or 6 points, but he's going to win by 8 or 10 points. So,
I think you're nuts. But anyway, it's a good question, because my view is, look, Nader went crazy and off the edge in 2000, and that's the reason we got George Bush. But at the same time, I do admit that you know, when you criticize the candidate, you may be, I mean, imagine that if this were like a more elevated platform and millions were watching, which they're not, but. You always kind of delude yourself into thinking that you have significance when you're in the opining business. You know, you do some damage to the candidate when you put bad spin on the stuff. But at the same time, to some extent, the base has got to hold their feet to the fire during the campaign, especially in things like this, to keep them from making definitive declarations that will be binding after the election. And that's why I'm glad that if you're right, that today they said, look, he totally misunderstood what a divided Jerusalem means, an undivided Jerusalem means. That's good. That's now an official clear walk back. But I admit that you can, it's a tough line, you know, between like me and Ralph Nader. But I would say that, you know, when B.J. Keith, I mean, does he feel the same way when Obama appoints this kind of conservative economic advisor, right? What's the guy's name?
Jason Furman.
Yeah. And labor unions complain, doing exactly what I'm doing on foreign policy, right? Is that bad, too? Or what? That's my question. That is my question for BJ. I leave it at that. Maybe he won't.
You're making all the arguments that I usually make, so I feel your...
I know, and it is a question. How am I not defending you?
I feel your pain, Bob.
I know, but I do maintain... I mean, here's some differences. When I do friendly fire, I confine it to issues of substances. You have repeatedly been known to do it on frivolous, scandally stuff that had nothing to do with holding their feet to the fire on policy. And the only discernible motive was to do damage.
Well, no, they're, you know, presidential character is important, and if the guy shows a weird character, that's going to affect the next issue that comes down the pike, and we don't know what that issue is. So character is always important, and also it's important if he has a political tenor. So
okay.
I smuggle it all in that way.
Yeah, that was
There are things about Obama that I don't say, Bob.
Would you care to share some of
this? No, they don't say them
with our vast viewing audience. What?
There are not many of them, but anyway.
There's nothing you know. There's maybe scurrilous rumors.
That's correct. The mythical Whitey tape being the most obvious scurrilous rumor that's just been revealed is pretty much bogus.
Just because Michelle denied it, you mean? This was the rumor that there was some tape where Obama denounces
Whitey. The biggest walk back was Bob Beckel, who went on Fox News and said he believed it existed, and then went on Fox News later and say, oh, it's just you right-wing people spreading this rumor, when in fact it was him spreading the rumor. So,
you know, I got to say, when Bob Beckel, when I see him on TV, he's this like warhorse Democratic consultant, right?
Right.
He is so profoundly unimpressive. And I mean, do you share this view?
I don't know. I'd rather have him than Jim Johnson, so. At least he's not a slick corporate.
Oh, by the way, you noted that Richard Holbrooke got the same sweetheart loan that Jim Johnson got?
Yeah, isn't that great? Joe Biden is really happy about that.
Why? Does he want to be Secretary of State?
You bet.
Joe Biden is Secretary of State?
It's
a guy who is totally incapable of controlling his mouth. That's like
I think he has that problem, Bob, but there you go, sabotaging the Democrats again.
No, some Democrats.
Okay. Yes, Holbrooke got
is that going to do damage, you think, to Holbrooke's chances of Secretary of State? Because word is, he's still gunning for it, even though Hillary is out of it.
But he was potentially Secretary of State in the McCain administration, too,
He's a man of all seasons. Man for all seasons, that guy.
Either way.
Impressive.
You can't.
Now, Mickey.
You can never rule him out. But that was a definite. I think that's a definite embarrassment, yes.
I just want to close with some bad news for you.
I have some bad news for you. You go first.
Okay. You know, you had been lauded for this quip of yours when I disappeared from the camera, and you said, well, Bob is away. We've replaced his coffee with Uban. Then you came on the next week and said, oh, I was wrong. It's actually instant Uban. And I had said, well, anyway, there were a couple of women I know who were impressed with your wit. Well, one of them, Brenda, Blogging Head Central, has done a little research, as we do often at Blogging Heads. Research.
Yeah.
And she reports that actually the coffee brand that we've secretly replaced in the secretly replaced ad campaign was Folgers Crystals, not Uban, Mickey.
Huh.
So
I'm so ashamed.
That's just, I don't know. I'm at a loss for an explanation. I mean, how could you, that's like, it almost reminds me of Obama's undivided Jerusalem.
Yeah, that's pretty bad.
Except harder to walk back, you know.
That's pretty embarrassing.
Yeah, makes you wonder. What do you have for me?
Well, I went to an event at Robert Greenwald's studio.
And who's Robert Greenwald?
He makes films, liberal films, like Outfoxed, and he made one about the recount, and he makes, you know, he churns out pretty good liberal propaganda films. I didn't see Outfoxed. I saw the one he did on the recount, which was tendentious, but actually was pretty surprisingly good. And he's a nice guy, but anyway, he has a whole studio where he's going to put bloggers on the air, Bob.
Uh-oh.
Including, he has a green screen, which you don't have. I don't know what a green screen can do, but it's very expensive, and he has one. He has a state-of-the-art studio in Culver City. He's going to have a show called Meet the Bloggers 2 days before Meet the Press, where bloggers go on and talk to bloggers.
Is it going to be on real TV as well as the Internet?
I don't think so. I think it's on the Internet. So I think and he has a fancy brochure, which I'm holding up, complete with CD. I don't see how you can compete with this, Bob. I would fold your tent right now.
I think it's time we just gave up. I agree. I think it's time we threw in the towel. Now, you know what they say when that happens in this business? They say, good, that validates the category. That's what they tell investors. They say, we welcome that. It validates the category. I would just like to thank him. What's his name?
Robert Greenwald.
I would like to thank him for validating the category.
Brave New Films. Okay, well, there you can send. I'll give you his email.
Brave New Films. I think they collaborated with David Korn on that nice. I think they're doing things with Mother Jones, and they did that nice takedown on McCain's other minister problem, Rob Parsley.
No, I think they have done things like that. So
yes, I applaud them. I applaud them. We're playing a non-zero-sum game with a Mickey because we're both validating the category.
That's very slick of you, Bob.
Thank you. I'm picking that up. You know, I've been in Silicon Valley talking to, like, rich people, and I'm getting really good.
Okay, well, unfortunately, wearing these sunglasses, you can't see me roll my eyes.
So have you really been wearing these? That's so wonderful.
I have to. I can't take them off. If I took them off, I'd be blinded by the light. I can't do that.
Well, that would be good TV, too, actually. You want to do that now at the very end?
I did that.
Just be blinded?
I did that. I grimaced.
Okay,
it's a Tiger, groovy. A Tiger Woods-like grimace.
Groovy.
Okay. So, anyway, see you next time.
Okay, see you.
Have a good trip.
And
raise lots of money.
And further goodbye. Yeah, I'll be back east next time. Okay.
Okay, see ya.
See you around.